This video was brought to you by GeneralPack.com, making power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Consider subscribing and supporting through patreon.com/GeneralPack. This is the mechanism for you to support us financially so we can continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Our corporate sponsor for this topic is AllumiaX.com from Seattle, Washington. Contact them for industrial and commercial power system studies. Reflecting a line-to-ground fault on the high-voltage side. In this video, we will see how we can actually reflect a line-to-ground fault current value, which occurs on the low-voltage side of the transformer, but reflected on the high-voltage side. So let's first have a recap of our video in part 3b-1, in which we calculated the fault current and voltage values for a single line-to-ground fault that occurs on the 13.8 kV bus or the low voltage side of the transformer, which is shown below. We also see the sequence component diagram as shown in that part. For a one line to ground fault type, we found that the positive sequence current was equal to negative J2.5 per unit, and also that the positive sequence current was equal to the negative sequence current, which also equaled the zero sequence current, again at negative J2.5 per unit. That can be expressed as 2.5 angle negative 90 in polar form. It is also important to note the subscript. The lowercase subscript indicates that the fault current values on the low voltage side. The uppercase will represent fault current on the high voltage side. We now proceed by reflecting these per unit current values on the high voltage side, and then we will multiply them with the appropriate base values to find the actual values. Given that we have a DY1 or a DAB transformer connection, to determine the high voltage positive sequence quantity, we will shift the low voltage positive sequence components by positive 30 degrees. And that can be done by multiplying the low voltage fault current by a value of 1 angle plus 30 degrees. And that gives us 2.5 at the angle of negative 60 degrees. In the same way, we will shift the negative sequence components by negative 30 degrees, and that can be done again by multiplying the low voltage fault current with a value of 1 angle negative 30 degrees. For the zero sequence component, however, it will be non-existent because the high voltage side is a delta side of the transformer and the delta windings do not allow zero sequence current to flow past them. They are trapped in the delta and keep flowing as a circulating current. To clarify, we again state that we will have zero sequence current on the low voltage side, but not on the high voltage side for this type of transformer connection. We need to use the base values to convert the per unit quantities to ampere quantities. However, since we are working on the high voltage side of the transformer, we divide the base value of power, which is 30 MVA, by the high side voltage, 115 kV, to get a base value of 150.6 amps. And then just multiply out the per units with the base values to get ampere quantities. We get 377 amps angled negative 60 degrees as a positive sequence current and 377 amps angled negative 120 degrees as the negative sequence current. Back to our familiar transformation equations, they can now be transformed to phase current quantities. Again, we would remove zero sequence current from these equations since they are not existent to simplify our calculations. These are the equations that we get. Now, plugging in the values of A to be 1 angle 120 degrees and A squared to be 1 angle 240 degrees and the positive and negative sequence components to be 377 angle negative 60 degrees and negative 120 degrees respectively, we get that the line current A equals 625 amps angle negative 90 degrees. Line current B equals 0, and line current C equals 625 amps angle positive 90 degrees. Now these values line up very well with the current flow path on the high voltage side. The fault current will only flow on the high voltage line A and high voltage line C for a low voltage line A one line to ground fault. Now the reason why that the fault current will flow to line A and line C on the high voltage side is because of the specific delta transformer connection we mentioned in part 4A of the series, which is also can be visually seen in the diagram below. It also makes sense that line A and line C current quantities are 180 degrees apart, which also supports the zero sequence current calculations, meaning even if we tried to calculate the zero sequence current using phase A, B, and C current quantities on the high voltage side, we still get zero, because I0 is equal to 1/3 of IA plus IB plus IC. And the zero sequence current, and plugging in line A current and line C current, we get simply equals to zero. 652 angle minus negative 90, minus 90 degrees, plus phase B current of 0, plus phase C current of 652 angle 90 degrees, multiplied by 1/3 gives us 0. Next, we will calculate the sequence voltage with our reflected sequence current components. To do that, we get back to our faulted sequence network diagram for a single line to ground fault and apply the KVL in each of the connected sequence networks. We can calculate the positive sequence voltage by considering that the voltage of the positive sequence source, 1 angle 0, and the impedance of the source, which is 0.05 per unit. The positive sequence voltage for a one line to ground fault is simply the source voltage minus the voltage drop across the positive sequence impedance. For the positive sequence voltage, we need to consider the reflective positive sequence current on the high voltage side, which is 2.5 angle negative 60 degrees. So our equation becomes the following. And we get a value of 0.89 per unit at the angle of negative 4 degrees. Similarly, the negative sequence voltage is the source voltage minus the voltage drop across the negative sequence impedance on the high voltage side. For the negative sequence current, we need to consider a reflected negative sequence current on the high voltage side, which is 2.5 angle minus 120 degrees. So our equation simply becomes the following. And we get the value of 0.125 per unit angle 150 degrees. Zero sequence voltage will be zero because the zero sequence current was also simply zero. We need to set up a base value to convert the per unit voltages to actual line to ground voltages. V base can therefore be taken as 115 kV over the square root of 3. Now multiplying the components with the base value, we get the value as shown below. The positive sequence voltage is equal to 59.3 kV angle negative 4 degrees, and the negative sequence voltage is equal to 8.3 kV at the angle of 150 degrees. Now a three legacy transformation equation will then transform the sequence components to actual one line to ground phase voltages. Again, since the negative sequence component is non-existent, we can eliminate that directly from our equation. And plugging in the calculated sequence component values, we get the following. We finally have the actual phase to ground voltages. VA is equal to 52 kV at the angle of 0 degrees. VB is equal to 66.3 kV at the angle of 120 degrees, and VC is equal to 60.5 kV at the angle of 108 degrees. For a one line to ground fault, we clearly see that the high voltage line A voltage is the most depressed since the fault was on line A on the low voltage side. We will also have some depression on the high voltage line C voltage. We don't see any significant depression on the high voltage line B voltage. This lines up very well with the current flow on the high voltage side. We calculated earlier that the high voltage fault current will only flow on line A and line C for a low voltage one line to ground fault on line A. The reason why the fault current will flow to line A and line C on the high voltage side is because of the specific type of delta connection. In terms of the voltage quantities on the high voltage side, the largest voltage depression will occur on line A, followed by line C, and then line B will not see any significant depression. Now, this was a very complicated video tutorial, but I hope that this video was useful and enlightening for students and professionals. Please subscribe and donate to patreon.com/generalpack so we can continue making high quality power system video tutorials. Thank you.